Amen. God is good. Jesus is coming soon. Amen. May we be all found worthy when the Lord comes again. Before we go to the message this morning, let us remember in our prayers the Sagdalen family. Carol's sister passed away this week. And so right now they are in the Philippines with Jude as our church deacon. Let us pray for God's comfort, that the Lord just visit them and bring provision and ministry in the Holy Spirit. Also, let us remember to pray the pastor, the Filipino pastor from Bakersfield. His wife passed away suddenly Saturday morning. I guess of heart attack, you know. Sister Raquel Dumanan. And they are right now in hour of sorrow. So let's bow down our heads and remember them in our prayers. Thank you, Jesus Christ. You are the God of comfort. And Lord, we bring to your throne of grace these two families, Lord. They're going through sadness and sorrow because of the passing away of their loved ones. One thing we know, God, that they're right now in your presence. One thing we know, Lord, that they are now in a much better place. And their time has come. But Lord, we remember them, though, as they go through this time, that the Holy Spirit's ministry will be surreal in their lives to bring comfort, provision, and blessings. Remember Pastor Dumanan, oh God, that he will stand strong in your grace. The sudden death of his wife, Lord. I pray, God, that as he goes through this hour of sadness, you will send forth people to bring comfort and encouragement to him, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Carol and June as well. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
And amen.
Praise God. Pastor Dumanan is my Bible school teacher way back in the late 70s. And he is a good teacher. And his late wife is also a good teacher as well. So remember that in your prayers. Hallelujah. How is the church today?
Amen.
Amen. Look around and say, how are you today? Are you blessed? Are you happy? God is good. The Lord is coming. Maranatha. Amen. Tell somebody Maranatha, meaning the Lord is coming. The Lord is coming. Maranatha. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I love the worship today. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to Jesus. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Who is, who was, and is to come. You know what, church? I personally believe that you are now in the last days.
Amen.
We cannot afford, let me say it again, we cannot afford to live a life that is spiritually complacent or without awareness of some potential event that will soon come upon the whole earth. We all know by observation, by way of information, through current events, in the light of biblical prophecy, that we're living in the last days.
Amen.
What is written in the Bible is really happening right before our eyes. We hear it, we see it, and we know it and feel it. Let us be ready for the coming of the Lord. What Jesus is saying to the church now, here I am, I stand at the door. Amen. Here I am, I stand at the door. He's not a mile away or two blocks away. The imminent return of Christ They're stressed out when it said, I stand at the door. Hallelujah. I stand at the door and knocking through the signs of the time. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with him and he with me. Let us be ready to open the door of his return. In relation to his return, church, the Bible has made it plain and simple for us believers to know the events that will take place. Bible scholars and denominations may vary from their interpretation of these events, but one thing for sure, all believers agree that Jesus is coming again and the church should make preparation for his return. Amen. Everyone agree that Jesus is coming again and the church should make preparation for his return. Hallelujah. Now today, in this message, we will differentiate the rapture from the second coming of Jesus Christ. What is the difference between the rapture and also the visible coming of Jesus Christ? Now the rapture is when Jesus Christ returns to remove the church, all believers in Christ, from the earth. Okay, take note. The rapture is when Jesus Christ will remove all believers in Christ from the earth. And the rapture is described in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to verse 18. Let's read this together. From the book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 18. It says there, brothers and sisters, addressed to the believers, brothers and sisters. Paul is saying, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or those who die, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. Why? The following verses. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Amen. Next verse. According to the Lord's own word, not for someone else's word, but according to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. Amen. Verse 16. For the Lord himself, not someone else, but for the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with a trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Amen. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds, to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. So we'll be with the Lord forever. Therefore, because of these preceding verses, therefore, encourage each other with these words. Jesus is coming soon. Amen. Amen. Jesus is coming again. Therefore, encourage each other with this was, if you believe the preceding verses, then you have the right to say, be strong, be of good courage, he is coming for you again. Hallelujah. And also, in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 50 to 54. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 50 to 54. What I'm saying, dear brothers and sisters, again addressed to the believers, right? Because of the word brothers and sisters. So I said, well, what I'm saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit what will last forever, right? Makes sense. The next verse, 51. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. Hallelujah. It will happen in a moment. This transformation will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet died will be raised to live forever, and we who are living will also be transformed.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Verse 53. For our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. The last verse. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, hallelujah, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. No wonder the coming of Christ is our blessed hope. The rapture. Now, the second coming is when Jesus returns to defeat the Antichrist, destroy evil, and establish his millennial kingdom. That is 1,000 years. The second coming is described in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 16. Let's read it together again. Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 to 16. I saw heaven standing open. John the Beloved saw this vision. I saw heaven standing open, and there before me was a white horse whose rider is called Faithful and True. Who is faithful and true? No one else but Jesus. Okay? With justice, he judges and makes war. Verse 12. His eyes are like blazing fire. Can you imagine that? And on his head are many crowns. He has a name written on him that no one knows but himself. Verse 13. He is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the Word of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word is God. And the Word became flesh, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. So he's here, dressed in linen white, and the armies of heaven, the armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. Verse 15. Out of his mouth comes a sharp sword with which to strike down the nations. He will rule them with an iron scepter and threads the white breast of the fury of the wrath of God Almighty. The last verse. And on his robe and on his thigh he has this name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is indeed coming. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Now, when it comes to the day and time of the rapture, no one knows, as Jesus said in Matthew 24, verse 36. Matthew 24, 36. No one knows about the day or hour, nor even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Okay? No one knows. Not a single person will be able to know or calculate the day or hour, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. If Jesus Christ doesn't know the time of his return, who among us can tell the hour and day of his return? No, not one, amen? Nor the Son of Man, but only the Father. Then also in verse 42 of Matthew chapter 24, Jesus also said, therefore, because in response to this, us not knowing the day and time, he said, therefore, keep watch. Why? Because you do not know on what day your Lord will return. And following these verses, Jesus gave the parable of the 10 virgins, warning his disciples the need for preparation and to be ready as well. But the visible coming of Christ, so therefore the rapture, anytime it will happen, anytime it will take place, amen. But the visible return of Christ is calculated to be after the 7 years tribulation, as recorded in the book of Revelation chapter 19. So the rapture is imminent, anytime soon will happen. It is, we call it a secret, nobody knows, but anytime we'll be transformed, we'll meet the Lord in the air, and then we will return with Christ, where the visible return of Christ will be seen by every eye. Now there are three theological theories as to when the rapture will take place. three theological theories as to when the rapture will take place. One, they called it the pre-tribulation rapture, the pre-tribulation rapture. The second one is the mid-tribulation rapture, and the third is the post-tribulation rapture. Now, every theory agrees on one thing, that there is going to be a 7 years great tribulation. Now, this calculation, again, is based from the book of Daniel and Revelation compared. The 7 years is divided into two parts. The first 3.5 years, where the Antichrist will be revealed and persecute believers beyond measure. In fact, the Bible said that there will be a carnage, that 1/4 of the world's population will die on the first 3.5 years. Well, today's calculation, I guess, how much? 2 billion? 1/4 of that? 2 billion or maybe more? You know, okay. Now, the second 3.5 years, the Antichrist and all unbelievers will experience the growing severity of God's anger and wrath. And after the 7 years, the visible second coming of Jesus Christ, you know, where every eye will see him come with glory and power, and the Antichrist, who is now possessed by Satan, will oppose the coming of Christ, and that's where the war of Armageddon will take place. And then, of course, victory is lost, and Satan will be bound for 1,000 years, and then Christ will establish his millennial reign here on earth for 1,000 years. Just for our chart here, I don't know if you can still read it way back, no. This is the pre-tribulation rapture. So the first here is the Old Testament time, and that is before the cross. Okay, next is after the cross, the church age. Right now, this is the church age. And then the pre-tribulation rapture believes that the rapture will take place before the 7 years begins. Okay, so the rapture will take place, and then the world will go through the 7 years tribulation period is divided into two. The first 3.5 years and the second 3.5 years. And after the 7 years, the second coming, the visible coming of Christ, where all the saints, the raptured saints, the resurrected saints, and all believers from history will come down with Christ and work the war of Armageddon. And then the millennium, the 1,000 years. In that 1,000 years, Satan will be bound in hell. There's no temptation, there's no trials there. There's going to be peace and prosperity and salvation within a millennial reign of Christ. And then eternity forever, the new heavens and the new earth, and then for eternity. Now, the mid-tribulation, mid-tribulation rapture believes this way. Go back to the second chart. The mid-tribulation rapture. Okay? The Old Testament time before the cross. And then after the cross is the church age. Alright? But yet, the mid-tribulation, the church will go through the first 3.5 years. After that, the rapture will begin. And then the last 3.5 years, what about the great tribulation? After the 3.5 years, then the second coming of Christ, and then again, the millennial reign of Christ. So that's the mid-tribulation, that in the middle of the 7 years, the rapture will take place. Okay, the post-trib rapture, let's go back to the next. Okay, the post-tribulation rapture, again, the Old Testament time before the cross, the church age after the cross, but yet the church will go through the 7 years tribulation. And in 7 years, the Lord will the rapture, the second coming will take place. There will be a U-turn. The rapture, then there will U-turn, you know, and then the war of Armageddon, then the millennium or the 1,000 years of Christ's return. Now, to my observation, every theory has their own debatable or arguments, you know, which one is true. Remember, you know, we don't know the hour of the day before. Argument's sake, let's look. Go back to the pre-tribulation. Let's go back to the first one. The pre-tribulation period. Now, the rapture is the indicator. Amen. Okay, the indicator when this tribulation will begin. So in this pre-tribulation, when the rapture takes place, that's the starting point of the countdown. to 7 years. The first 3.5 years will be a carnage. Antichrist will rise. Anyways, I will discuss more about that next Sunday. We'll talk about the Great Tribulation next Sunday. One sermon about the Great Tribulation. What's taking place in the Tribulation? And are you willing to go on through that? Okay? So, this is the rapture is the starting point of the countdown of the 7 years Tribulation and then the visible return of Christ. Now, go to the mid-trib. And some hold also the mid-trib tribulation, that the rapture will take place in the mid-trib. But my point, the personal question is, when did the first 3.5 years begun? When did the first counting or the first 3.5 years begun or begins? Right? With the rapture, with the pre-trib, you know where it begins. Those who are left behind, if today's the rapture, tomorrow is the first day of the first 3.5 years. So if you're left behind, oh, this is the first day, they have to look for 3 or 4, 7 years to survive this. If you're left behind. But with the mid-trib, when will it begin? Well, I've made a research that they said we are right now in the first 3 years. The situation, the political government, the economic issues, blah, blah, all those sort of things, but what we hear and we're seeing is already the part of the 3.5 years. So anytime, the Lord also will come. But yet, it is counted, 3.5 years. You know what I mean? So when do we begin? The first day of the first 3.5 years, that's my personal observation there, well, unlike with the pre-trib. Now the post-trib, same thing. Let's go back to the post-trib. Is this a post-trib during the rapture? Yeah. So, again, when do we begin the first day of the 7 years? If the rapture and the second coming will end at the 7 years. And next week, we'll see how hard it is to be in the Great Tribulation. And I wonder if God will allow the church to go through the wrath of God. Amen? But nevertheless, church, the bottom line is, are you ready for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ here? Yes. Amen? The Assemblies of God in general is a pre-trib denomination. But some pastors and teachers believe in the mid-trib tribulation. Okay? All AG denomination believes in the pre-trib tribulation, but some still hold on the mid-trib tribulation. Whatever it is, are you ready for the coming of the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. We'll defy our theology and forget about our spirituality. Amen. Now, so great. Either pre-trib, mid-trib, or post-trib, the question, the bottom line is, Jesus Christ is coming again. Are you ready for his return?
Amen.
Are you ready to open the door? Because Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and I am knocking. Hallelujah. And he is knocking now through the signs of the times.
Yes.
Are you ready to open the door for his return? Glory to Jesus. Amen. Now, just few differences between the rapture and second coming are as follows. At the rapture, believers will meet the Lord in the air. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. Okay, at the rapture, believers meet the Lord in the air. That is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever. Amen. In a twinkling of an eye, amen. In a twinkling of an eye, the dead will rise first, and we who are alive will be transformed, and we will meet the Lord in the air. Amen. At the second coming, believers return with the Lord to the earth. Revelation chapter 19, verse 14. Okay, Revelation chapter 19, verse 14. The armies of heaven were following him, riding on white horses and dressed in fine linen, white and clean. So that's the text there. Now the rapture will be secret and instant. That is 1 Corinthians 15, verse 50 to 54, as read. I declare to you, brothers, the flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable. Verse 51, listen, I tell you mystery, we will not all sleep, but we will all be changed, amen, we will all be transformed. Verse 53, For the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. The last verse. When the perishable has clothed with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality, then the saying that is written will come true, death has been swallowed up in victory. Hallelujah. Now the second coming of Christ will not occur until after certain other end times event. Okay? That takes place as recorded in the book of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Now the rapture is imminent. It could happen anytime soon. Are you with me? It can happen at any moment. Therefore, the rapture and second coming are similar but separate events. Both involve Jesus returning. Both are end times events. However, it is crucially important to recognize the differences. In summary, the rapture, what is the return of Christ in the clouds to remove all believers from the earth before the time of God's wrath. The second coming is the return of Christ to the earth to bring the tribulation to an end and to defeat the Antichrist and his evil world empire. Now, there are Old Testament analogy that Jesus even mentioned in the book of the Gospel of Luke about these things. Okay? Luke chapter 17, verse 26 to 27, about the Lord sparing his people from the coming judgment. Luke 17, verse 26 and 27. Just as it was in the days of Noah. Remember Noah's days? So Jesus said, just as it was in the days of Noah, so also will it be in the days of the Son of Man. Many people were eating. Is that the signs of the time? We have much eating yesterday. That's a sign of Christ's soon return. Hallelujah. People were eating, drinking, marrying, and even being given in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark. Then what happened? Then the flood came and what? Destroyed them all. Amen. I don't know what scholar, biblical or Bible scholars will talk about this, you know, but I stand that the church will be spared from the wrath of God to come. As it was in the days of Noah. Amen. As it was in the days of Noah. Hallelujah. And then up to the day Noah entered the ark, then the flood came and destroyed them all. Now the ark is a type or symbolizes Jesus Christ, and the flood symbolizes the judgment of God upon the evil people. So before the flood came, Noah and his family were saved. Amen. Hallelujah. Second one is in Luke 17, 28 to 30. It was the same in the days of Lot. People were, again, what? Eating, drinking, buying, and selling, planting, and building. Isn't that the signs of our days now? Hallelujah. Amen. So let's all do a diet. But the day Lot left Sodom. Amen. Good note. But the day Lot left Sodom, fire and sulfur rained down from heaven and destroyed them all. Two words, destroyed them all. In Noah, destroyed them all. The judgment will destroy the wicked of this world. Yes. Amen. Hallelujah. It will be just like this on the day the Son of Man is revealed. Hallelujah. Meaning, on before the day of God's judgment, he will spare his own people. He will remove you from this. Today, right now, all over the world, Christians are going through some kind of persecution and a hard place. But yet, nothing yet about to come. When Antichrist also will be revealed. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So as I close the message this morning, the challenge for the church today is watch and pray, for you do not know when the Lord will come. Did you hear me, church? That is the challenge for the church today. If Jesus is saying to the church now, in our generation, behold, I stand at the door and knock, then the challenge for us now is watch and pray, for you do not know when the Lord will come. Wake up from your spiritual slumber. Lift up your heads. Your salvation is near. And the parable of the 10 virgins is indeed a relevant message for the church today. Be wise and not foolish. Make preparation. The bridegroom is coming soon.
Amen.
Amen. I don't know if my memory serves me right, but somehow I learned about the Jewish culture about getting married. The lover will go to his fiancé, make proposal for the marriage, and if it is accepted, he will go back to his father's house and make preparation. But it is the father who decides the day and time the bridegroom will meet the bride. So the father decides. That's why with this background, nobody knows, not even the son, but only father, when the son will come for the wedding supper of the Lamb. Amen. For the wedding supper of the Lamb. So don't panic. Amen. Don't panic. My family back home made long distance call because they were scared. Because they heard something and they're scared. What's going to happen? What's going to happen? What are we going to do? We need to prepare. We need to prepare. I said, don't panic. Rejoice. Lift up your hands. Jesus is coming soon.
Amen.
Don't be troubled. Be ready. Amen. Be wise. Be wise and get ready. Don't panic. Be glad and rejoice because your Savior, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, is coming for you.
Amen.
He is coming for you. The message of his return is not to scare people.
Yes.
If you are not ready, you will be scared. You will be, you should be. But if you're ready, it's a time of rejoicing. Lift up your head. Jesus is coming soon. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Amen. Amen. I read the news the other day that Myanmar dropped a bomb in one island of China. Wars and rumors of wars.
Oh, yes.
From the snow, now the floodings. Because the snow is starting to melt, and rivers are rising up, and floods again. Recently, there's an earthquake somewhere getting chilly, an earthquake here, an earthquake there, and famine here, and famine there, and sickness here, and sickness there. We hear it, we see it. Jesus is knocking at the door. Are you listening? Are you listening? Are you ready to open the door for his return? You can whisper in the back of the Lord, please postpone. I'm not ready yet. The house is not clean yet. I have not vacuumed yet. Lord, please postpone your coming. No, it is not your time. It is his time. Ready or not ready, here I come. Have you been playing hide and seek? Ready or not ready, here I come. I come. And one time, I hope, when the Lord returns, we are ready, and he will find us worthy of his return. Usually, my little Joseph likes to play hide and seek. Daddy, daddy, find me, find me. He will run. He will run and hide. I would say, Joshua, where are you? I'm not here, Dad. I'm not here. I'm not here, Dad. I will think about, where are you? and it's under the blood. I'm not here, Dad. I'm not here. I'm in school. I'm in school right now. I'm not here. And I'll come and tickle him, you know. Well, when the Lord comes, ready or not ready, here I come. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. He will not play hide and seek with you, saying, "Are you ready? Are you ready? Here I come. Here I come." God is good. He's coming for you. He's coming for you. Whether the world is stable or not, and sinati, there's no stability here. He will come soon. We know it. Let us pray. Father God, thank you. That even Lord, in times like this, that the current events are pointing to the imminent return of Christ, I pray, God, that we'll make preparation for your return, that we'll not be complacent nor ignorant about a potential event that is coming upon the earth. I pray, God, as the song says, may we be found worthy when the Lord returns. Father God, there's no doubt. Yes, there's no doubt. Jesus is coming soon. Yes. Hallelujah. Anytime soon. If ever we are right now in the tribulation time, give us the strength to overcome, not to give up the faith. We're living in hard times, oh God, last days. But the bottom line, oh God, is for us to watch and pray. To be busy in fulfilling our life's purpose. Busy, Lord, to express our godly passion. Busy, Lord, in witnessing to others about the love of Jesus Christ, that they may know that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is coming soon. Yes. Hallelujah. Yes, oh God, help us to rejoice. Not to panic, oh God, not to be scared, but to look to heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Examine our hearts now. The Bible said that he will come for a church without a spot or wrinkles, but a bride is worthy to be presented before the Father. Thank you, Lord. Jesus is coming soon.